Hey, look at that, I have the clap now. Today's video is in the code review series where I show you actual systems I developed for an actual real-life game project. And today's topic is all about perspective, depth, and collisions. Our game has isometric 2D graphics. The player can walk around in this environment where perspective looks 3D, even though everything is actually flat. So we have to fake depth somehow, starting with the visuals. Moving the character around and placing them behind or in front of object is actually trivial. The depth of an object in the scene is proportional to its position on the y-axis, so we can just set the ordering layer of every sprite to be a function of its y-coordinate. For the player character and other dynamic objects, we just update the order at every frame and we're good. We can move around objects with ease. There's a little bit of additional math involved for floating objects, but this is really not what this video is about. What I want to talk to you about today is physics. The game needs to detect multiple interactions between objects such as projectiles. We want to delete projectiles when they hit a wall, and we also need to detect whether they are behind or in front of objects. Using 2D colliders is out of question because they don't care about depth or sorting order as long as objects overlap. To put it simply, the collision is triggered if two pixels overlap, regardless of depth. And I can't use 3D colliders either because, well, everything is flat because the perspective is drawn into the background image, conflating the vertical axis and the depth axis. For instance, let's look at this object. Without more information, we don't know if it is a vertical pole or a fallen tree trunk. Same thing for this ball. Is it here on the ground or is it hovering above ground at a different position? When we go up along the y-axis, there's no way to tell if we're flying upward vertically or if we're walking on the ground toward the back of the scene. This is also where you realize shadows are paramount to the anchoring of objects in their environment. Having shadows in your game, even if they are fake ellipses placed below your characters, greatly improves readability. Everything is flat, the information is baked into a texture we can't realistically access, so how exactly is it that I can do this? I'll cut to the chase, I did use 3D colliders, but since I couldn't place them in our flat 2D environment, I made some sort of parallel world where 3D is a thing. Dynamic objects, or objects that interact with dynamic objects, have a child object called 3D body. These objects are prepared 3D colliders with a rigid body and a script called, surprise surprise, 3D body. At runtime, all 3D body objects will set their target property as the current parent transform. This way, they know what object they're tracking, and then they will move out of this object to a separate place. Currently, it is just the root of the scene, but I guess I could make things more tidy by regrouping everyone in a 3D world object. And then, every frame, the 3D body will update its position to match the position of the 2D object, except in 3D space. The X position remains the same, but remember when I told you the isometric perspective conflated the Y and Z coordinates? Well, it's time to unconflate them by setting the 3D Y coordinate to 0 because objects are on the ground, and the 3D Z coordinate is simply the 2D Y multiplied by a perspective factor. On top of that, for objects that are above ground, I added an offset property where I manually track the altitude of objects. All objects are placed on the ground, but their collider is offset to an altitude that is tracked by the system. This is useful for projectiles because I can both know where the impact is and also where the ground is in order to add a shadow to the object. 3D world is on a different plane of existence. It doesn't show up on camera obviously, but I needed a way to view what's happening there for debug purposes and also when designing more complex colliders and primitives. The way I set it up, 3D body objects do have renderers, but they're placed on the 3D world layer, which the game camera does not see. I added a second camera that exclusively films this layer and has basic control to follow a target, rotate around it, zoom in, zoom out, etc. This camera outputs the second display so I can have a second game view or monitor and watch in real time both the game view and the 3D parallel world to check if the thickness of colliders is right or why an arrow gets deleted before hitting a wall, this sort of things. It's really fun to have two games running in parallel with different views, and in a release build, we'll simply remove the 3D world camera and everything works fine. Now, how do the 2D game and 3D world coexist, as both have colliders? The 2D world does have colliders because they are hand-drawn and we wanted to make it extremely easy to integrate our complex backgrounds. We just draw the colliders on a texture as a separate layer, and we have accurate colliders for our character to run into. So both will have colliders, and even if Unity 2D physics and 3D physics could interact, which they can't, we would get an overly constrained environment with contradictory info from both physics systems. The solution was to make the 2D game the main physics system. 3D world is set up to be passive. As I said, position of 3D bodies is manually updated from the position of 2D objects, but also colliders for 3D bodies are in fact triggers, meaning everything in 3D world is a ghost and will allow objects to collide and overlap. 3D world is simply here to send collision information to the game. For instance, when an arrow hits a wall, the two 3D triggers collide and the 3D body script will start tracking the collision and send a message saying there was a collision and who is involved to whomever subscribed to this event. If nobody subscribed, the system goes on. In the case of our arrow though, we have an arrow controller script that listens to the on-enter event and if the proper conditions are met, will delete the arrow from existence. In short, this 3D world runs parallel to the 2D game, reads from it to upgrade itself, then feeds back info on 3D collisions which the 2D game might choose to listen to and act upon. But anyway, that's 3D world and how it works. Sometimes I wonder if I should flip this around and make 3D world the main physics system and make 2D world simply a view, a renderer that uses 2D to reflect the state of the game. However, as it now stands, the comfort of being able to set up colliders for the characters so easily by drawing them is enough to make me keep this current setup, as moving the physics to 3D would certainly mean we have to somehow model colliders for the very organic shapes of the environment, which we certainly don't have time for. I hope you enjoyed this video. The next one in the code review series will most probably be about scene management, but the next one on the channel will definitely be a useless game dev video. I've already started working on the code for that project, so subscribe to make sure you don't miss it. Have a good one, everybody.